Turn to your neighbor. Tell him you're blessed. You're highly flavored. And you're highly favored if you're in position. Oh, yeah. You can't be favored if you ain't in position. Amen. How can you be blessed if you're out of position? You know what happens when you're out of position? You get run over. And those are not the stripes of healing. Those are the stripes of tires. Some of us are walking around with treads on us. Glory! Is everybody okay?
Amen.
And highly flavored. 1 Peter chapter 5. How many of y'all know we're in the last days?
Amen.
Yeah. We are in a year of exposure.
Amen.
Where it's a magnitude of exposure. You will see more and more things happening. You know, we are in a time in the beginning of sorrows, which is almost ended. Then tribulation comes. He said that it will be rumors of war. There'll be wars, there'll be famine, there'll be pestilence. It'll be the beginning of sorrows. Why? Because there'll be much sorrow. And then there'll be tribulation, then great tribulation. Then the end of the age. And that's the end of the age of grace. Because eventually grace will be removed. And then people will have to go through tribulation. We are in exciting times right now. You know, the media's got all kinds of stuff going on. The internet's got all kinds of stuff going on. And my encouragement to you is stay strong and close to the Lord. You get your information from Him and through the truth of His Word. Because if it doesn't line up with the Word, don't believe it.
Amen.
The Word tells us that many will come. Many will come. In His name, many will come, saying they've got revelation, many prophets, many false Christians. Many people say they are Christians and really are not. Many will come and deceive many people, and they will fall back into the tradition of men, trusting more in man and in the worldly possessions and worldliness than God. Remember, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, and the first thing he wants to steal is your identity. When he steals your identity, he's got you. You compromise your identity, he already has you. Compromising. There's much deception, delusion, and confusion going on. And there'll be even a more of an increase of delusion. God is allowing this. He's going to allow people to be deceived. Only those that come to him will not be deceived. But those who think that they can compromise in both areas, he says, you cannot serve two masters. Amen? You cannot serve the world and God. You can't. So you're either going to serve God or not. Well, if you serve God one day and the world the next day, then you're not serving God. If he said that you can make it to heaven by serving two masters, he would tell you. But he says you cannot make it to heaven by serving two masters. Amen. It's an area right now which is vitally important. We are going to reach greater depths in the arena of evilness and wickedness. You know, the Word tells us it'll be as the days of Noah and Sodom and Gomorrah. And we are in them. You know, it was pretty amazing to me. And don't get me wrong, because in the days of Noah and Sodom and Gomorrah, what reigned here was evil. In fact, they were Nephilims. They were offsprings of the angels that went into women and produced offsprings, the fallen angels. They were ruling here. And during that rule, the Lord says that this is going to happen again. And let me share something with you. One of the main things that they were involved in is perversion. It says that their minds, their thoughts were constantly wicked. They were homosexuals. They were lesbians. These were perverse, sick spirits destroying mankind, trying to corrupt humanity and change the DNA of mankind. And it is happening now, what you're seeing all over. It's repeating itself, and it's getting greater. I've never seen so many women dress up as men in my life. I've never seen so many men dress up as women in my life. And some of them don't even know what they are. Because we are in the times of Noah and Sodom and Gomorrah. We are in those times right now. And these are spirits that are invading these bodies and taking these people over. They're yielding right to these demonic forces, not knowing the truth. They're rebellion, protesting, not even knowing that they're coming against the will of God and their salvation of eternity. When God is trying to bring a rescue to them. And that's why you and I are to bring a rescue to them. We don't condemn them. Amen? We want to rescue them. That's the importance. So we're to know truth. We're to love truth, not compromise it. And there's a place and position where God wants me and you to be so that we are not overtaken, deceived, misled, or destroyed. So he said, come and learn from me. Why? Because if you don't learn, you're going to burn. First Peter chapter 5, and verse 6. Therefore, what? Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God that he may what? Exalt you in due time. In other words, don't build your own house. Let God build. You stay humble, he'll promote you. You get prideful, he'll demote you. He says, casting your cares upon him, for he what? Cares for you. That's where you're making that exchange. Two vital keys. These are two words right here to overcome. He said, therefore, what be what? Sober, which means alert. Sober means to be what? Alert. It actually also means to be awake. So you want to be alert and a what? Awake. Be vigilant, which means to be consistent. Or what it also means is be risen, risen above. Because your adversary, the devil, the powers of darkness, demons, walks about like a roaring lion. In other words, he speaks, trying to deceive us, seeking whom he may deceive or devour. He throws out the hook and people are biting bait, baiting. He baits all the time. It says, resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing that the what? Same sufferings, these sufferings are what? Experienced by your brotherhood in the world. In other words, you're not the only one going through it. Now, this is powerful right here. Are you ready? It says, but may the God of all grace, in other words, all the plans, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus after you have what? After you have what? After you have what? Suffered. So what he's trying to tell you, it starts with suffering. You know, if you're trying to escape suffering, you ain't going to grow. People always run from everything when they go through trials and tribulations. Woe is me. Shut up and get filled up. Suffering. Everyone suffer. Come on, say it. Suffer. Suffering is my training. Well, then stop running from it. Suffering is my training. What's it going to do? Look at watch. He says, after you what? Have suffered a while. A while. That means his time, not yours. Okay, that's enough. I'm done, Lord. No, it don't work that way. No. What's he trying to do? This suffering is in the arena where he's trying to not only expose your impurities, but your enemies. But people run from it, and then you know what they do? They go back in that cycle over and over and over and over. They might as well ride a bicycle and just stay in darkness. I think that was on what's it, Wizard of Oz, when the witch was riding that bicycle. Yeah. You're riding that bicycle, you know. So all she stole was dogs, you know. Hallelujah. So after you what? Suffered a while. Whoa, what's coming next? Now, are you ready for this? Can you handle this? Are you ready? What's the next word? Perfect. So are you going to get perfected without suffering?
No.
Oh. So you think you can skip it? No. All right. Cool. So he's going to bring you through suffering to perfection, to establish, to strengthen you, and to settle you so you are no longer moved. 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 So the two key words is to be what? Alert, sober, or vigilant, alert. In other words, what he's saying is, I want you awake, and I want you in a risen, resurrection state of being. Oh, glory. Now, you're going to go through suffering through persecution, loss of family, worldly desires, friends. You're going to see things, you're going to lose possessions. You're going to go through sufferings through sickness. Listen, there isn't one person that doesn't go through sickness. And people start boasting, I've never been sick. 2 weeks later, they're sick. Everybody goes through sickness. I don't care if it's flu, virus, whatever. It's a part of suffering. God doesn't put it on you, the enemy does. But God brings you through it. Because he'll use what the enemy gives you for training. Hello? You're going to go through rejection. You're going to get offended. You're going to be tempted. Woo-hoo. Why are you going through the sufferings? For training. Amen? Why? You want to gain a more spiritual place with power, with resurrection. How many of y'all want to be back by heaven? I'd rather be back by heaven than hell. So that we get to a place where we are not only walking in a position of perfection, we are walking in stability, we are walking in strength, and we are solid. Solid. Turn to your neighbor and say, get solid. I didn't say sail it, I said solid. This is meat, not vegetarian. Matthew 16. Oh, glory. Matthew 16. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Matthew 16:13. Glory. Is everybody there? Let's speak it together. When Jesus came in the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do men say that I am? You know, most people try to find Jesus by what everybody else says instead of what their seeking is. And they said, some John the Baptist, some Elijah, others Jeremiah and other prophets. And Jesus said to them, who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? Who am I to you? Not what anybody else says. Who am I to you? And Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ. You are the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty, the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. In other words, he heard the voice of God. And also I say to you, that you are Peter, and on this revelation of the anointing, which is called the rock is the anointing. Why? Jesus is the anointed one, and his anointing. Then the anointing is the eternal presence, power, or truth of God Almighty. He said, so on this rock, I'm going to build my church. So your foundation is on the anointing, not on the word. You build on the anointing with the word. Does everybody get it? That's why many people try to build on the word, and it's not backed by the anointing, and it crumbles. He said, and I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I'm going to give you keys. I'm going to give you authority when you build upon the anointing. When your foundation is the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty, His presence, which breaks every yoke of bondage, which the keys of authority are associated with the anointing. He said, and I'll give you the keys of authority, the keys of the kingdom, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be what? Loosed in heaven. Wow. Then he commanded his disciples that they should tell no one that he was the anointed one. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go through Jerusalem and do what? He must what? Suffer. Hello? He must what? Suffer. Many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be what? Killed. And be risen and rise the third day. Then, oh, here's Peter. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord. This shall not happen to you. And Jesus turned and said to him, get behind me, Satan. Get behind me, Satan. You are what? An offense to me. For you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of what? Man. Oh. Then Jesus said to his disciples, he finishes this off. See, the devil always wants to fight for first place. God is waiting for first place. The devil wants to steal your first place. So it's your responsibility to say, Satan, get behind me. Has everybody got it? It's your responsibility. Satan, get behind me. Anything that would interrupt your relationship with the Lord is the powers of darkness. Get behind me, Satan. Why? Because there's a fight for first. It's constant. It doesn't stop. And then Jesus confirms this. He says, okay. Remember, he first asked, what do men say? Then who do you say? Am I first? Is it me and you? Or are you still getting things from the world? Are you so busy getting information, knowledge, and intellect that you ain't got no relationship with me personally? Does everybody get this? And he says, if anyone desires to come after me, oh, that means he says, you better, look, I'm gonna draw you, then I'm going to step back. I'm going to step back. Why? Because he's saying, I want you to come after me. Because during the come after him, you're going to go through suffering. And again, as you're chasing the Lord, as you're seeking the Lord, you're going to go through suffering. Why? That suffering's for training, for reigning. It's to expose your what? Impurities in your enemies. And anyone who desires to come after me, let him what? Deny himself. Himself. In other words, he just rebuked Peter, he said, because you're an offense to me. Why? You're mindful of things of men and not God. But he called Satan that was influencing Peter. It was a spirit. See, the enemy always wants first place. There's that fight for first place all the time. So he said, Jesus said again, if you're going to follow me, if you're going to chase after me, you're going to go through suffering so that you can train. I'm going to expose your enemies. I'm going to show your impurities. And I'm going to give you keys if you're not using them. I'm giving you keys of authority to bind and loose. Use them. But if you're not backed by the anointing, if you're not walking in the Spirit, you're not going to use them. You won't even think about them. You'll be busy blaming everybody else for your garbage. You're going to blame everybody else for your decisions. Oh, what's his name? Did this. That's why I did this. Well, you're a stinking idiot. Why? Because don't blame. That ain't about the world. That's called mindful things of the world. That isn't mindful things of God. Mindful things of God says, I bind you. Mindful things of God sees through the physical. Amen. Realize that the person's influence is from the unseen realm. And Jesus said, look at, if you're going to have to deny yourself if you want to come after me. And then you're going to have to take your cross up. Remember, when you pull the cross out of the ground, what does it become? A sword. Amen. So you're going to have to fight. See, people want to follow without a fight. It ain't going to work. You can't follow without a fight. And you can't fight without a denial. So if you're not willing to deny yourself, then you can't fight. And if you're not willing to fight, you can't follow. He said, look, man, you're going to have to deny yourself, pick up the cross, you're going to have to fight to follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. It's all about me. See, people want to save your life, live for themselves. They say they love God. Now, they may be awakened, but they're not risen. Oh, glory. See, you may be an awakened and know these things, but you're not walking in the resurrection state of being. See, the resurrection state of being exposes everything, says no to the devil, hates evil, and loves truth. Doesn't manipulate, doesn't lie, doesn't cheat. Is honest in every area. Or you've fallen back into the cycle. Doesn't compromise. Need revelation. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? Many people are exchanging. They're selling out their souls for compromise, for fulfillment. But this is what I need. No, you need him. Because without him, you're nothing. And anything that you go and get that's not from him, you got to maintain. Is everybody okay? We need revelation, truth. Revelation is truth with understanding. See, many people have, I know the truth, but they don't understand it. Then it's really not truth, is it? Knowledge with understanding becomes truth. We need revelation, understand, release to you who's from Jesus. In other words, it brings the reality of who Jesus is. And when you know who he is, you know who you are. Remember, he's given us keys of authority using the resurrection state of being. So you become awakened, then you step into resurrection. Jesus was the example of much suffering to reach a position intended for the destiny of God. Satan wants first place to stop transformation of Christ's character and position of victory. It is a position where you are victorious. You don't lose battles. Amen? Oh, glory. I'm going to go a little bit further with this. Now, look at this. So, in verse 27, he says, for the Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will what? He will what? So there is a reward to be in position, isn't there? He will reward each one according to his works. Wow. Luke 4. Glory. Hallelujah. Are you all right? Amen. Luke 4. Remember, Jesus said, get ye behind me, Satan. Get behind me, Satan. Why? You are an offense to me. You are mindful of the things of man. In verse 8, Jesus answered and said to Satan again, "Get behind me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve." So there's that place again where you are in position where not only do you worship him, but you serve him. It's a place of worship and service. Why? Because the enemy doesn't want you there. He does not want you in that place of worship and service. Now, first of all, you can't give what you don't have. So God is trying to get us to another place and position to serve. But the first thing he wants us to do is be sons and daughters. That's where he says, who do men say, but who do you say I am? That's a son and daughter. That relationship. Because you can't, listen, you can't trust someone that doesn't trust you. And God is not going to trust you if you can't trust him. Even if you say it, he's going to bring you through testing to see if you do trust him. Oh, I trust him. Yeah. Yeah, you trusted him when you said it, but when you went through it, you didn't. That's the test. John 11. Where we get behind me, Satan. Anything that wants to take first place in your life is not God. John 11, please. Hallelujah. Verse 38. Let's speak it. And Jesus, again groaning in himself, came to the tomb of Lazarus. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. And Jesus said, what? Take away the stone. Did Jesus take away the stone? So whose responsibility to take away the stone he hurt? Ours. Take away the stone. Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to him, Lord, by this time there is a what? Stench. Believe sin smells. For he has been dead 4 days. And Jesus said to her, did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was lying. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me. Because of the people who are standing by, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me. Now, when he had said these things, he cried out with a what? Loud voice. He cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus, come forth. Come forth. See, God is always calling me and you to come forth. But you can't hear with a stony heart. You can't go through that stony heart. You can't hear God with a hardened heart. You can't hear God with offense. You can't hear God with bitterness. You can't hear God with unforgiveness. You can't hear God with sin. You can't hear. Your heart's hard. You can't hear. And he who had died came out bound, hand and foot. He came out hopping like a rabbit. With what? Grave clothes. And his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to him, what? Loose him. In other words, use authority. Loose him and what? Let him go. Loose him and let him go. In other words, we got to remove that heart of rebellion. We got to remove that heart of bitterness, heart of unforgiveness, that heart. Hardened heart. It's dead. It becomes dead. We become dead with God in the area where you can't hear correctly, see correctly, and receive correctly. Jesus is calling me and you. First of all, Lazarus could not rise until he was first awakened. even though he was carrying dead clothes, he was carrying the cloth of a dead man until he was loosed. See, many people have awakened, but they're still walking around with dead clothes, dead garments, because they can't hear or see. Because they're still allowing devil to have first place. Why? Because they're still associated with the cares of this world. They're still associated with all the things. Me first. Oh, I love God. Oh, no, you don't. Look, you say you love God, he'll test you. He wants to get you a place of not loving him, but being in love with him. There's a difference. When you're in love with the Lord, you lay down your life. When you just love him, you say, well, you know. Well, I love you, Lord, but, you know, I got this first. So he's not first. That's where people become anxious. The word says, be anxious for nothing, but all things through what? Prayer and supplication. Why? Because when people are anxious, what do they want to do? They're first. Me. I. Oh, glory. What's happening is God is trying to bring us through these sufferings, trials, and tribulations so that we come to a place where we are awake and in a resurrection state of being, where we're willing to say, get behind me, Satan, and anything that tries to take first place. Anything. Relationships, jobs, money, ministries, whatever it is. You can't allow anything to take first place. Ephesians 5. Oh, glory. Sure got quiet in here. Turn to your neighbor and say, wake up. You know, as soon as you begin to hear eyes in your thoughts, I need, I this, I that, be careful. Ay, yay, 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 yay. I call it a demonic pizza. You must be careful. The only thing I need you. That's the only eye. Every eye ought to be connected to the presence of God. Every eye ought to be connected to truth. If it's not connected and it's connected to anything else, then something else has first place. Ephesians 5:8. Is everybody okay? Listen, this is reality. This is truth. This is what we're in. There's a wave going to come. It's going to move quick. If you're not anchored, you're going to caught in it. It's a wave of deception. Great deception. If you're not anchored in truth, if you're not anchored in this, if anything is taken first place, when that wave, a flood of the enemy comes, you'll be taken with it. Ephesians 5:8, would you read it with me? For you were what? Once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, finding out what is what? Acceptable to the Lord. And have no fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness, but rather what? Expose them, man. Come on. That's it. We were once dark, now walk in the light, right? Now expose these things. Don't compromise them. Don't justify them. Don't put them away. Get rid of them. Get behind me, Satan, who's trying to take first place. See, he calls these things unfruitful works of darkness. Anything that tries to take first place. He says, for it is shameful to speak of those things which are done by them in secret. But all things that are exposed are made manifest by the light. For whatever makes manifest is light. Therefore, he says, awake, you who sleep. Arise from what?
The dead.
And Christ will give you light. In other words, awake and get into the place of resurrection or risen state of being. It's a position where you see things through, hear things through, where you don't allow anything to be first, nothing. Again, there are many who are awake from the dead, but they're not risen to the new life. They're not walking in that place because still there's too many things that have taken first place in their life. In Matthew 27, oh, hallelujah. We want truth, right? Get behind me. Get behind me. Matthew 27. Matthew 27, verse 50, please. Jesus is on the cross. Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked and the rocks were split. Then what? The graves were opened. The graves were open, right? And many of the bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. In other words, they were awakened. Does everybody see this? But they didn't come out yet. And it says, and coming out of the graves after what? Jesus' resurrection. So when Jesus went into the earth, this happened. For 3 days, these bodies laid there. Why Jesus was kicking butt. Then when Jesus rose, they rose with him. And what? Coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they what? They went into the holy city and appeared to many. In other words, they were awakened, then risen as what? Witnesses. See, that resurrection arena, that resurrection state of being is a place of witness. See, because you can truly speak without no conviction. You can truly witness knowing that there isn't anything you're hiding. There isn't anything that you have an incorrect intention or a motive or a desire or a manipulation. There's nothing. You are clean. You are pure. Your heart is pure. Your hands are clean. Now you can walk in resurrection state of being. Other than that, you can't. You can't. Now you're walking in the power of the Spirit. Because only through the power of the Spirit will you hear, get behind me. Ephesians 2. Oh, yes. Get behind me. You're going to need to say that to some movies. You're going to need to say that to some books, some of your family members. You can say it underneath your breath to your boss. Hallelujah. Ephesians 2, verse 1. Let's begin together. And you he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of what? Disobedience. Among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh. Oh man, that means you first. Fulfilling the desires of the flesh, you first. And of the mind, me first. And we're by nature children of wrath. That was the reward when you're first. Just as the others. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were idiots, dead in trespasses, made us alive. He called us together by Christ through the word of the Lord and through his plan called grace, and raised us up together and made us sit. Made us sit. Said, man, I'm putting you right here. Because you were awakened and now you're risen. And if you're walking in a risen state of being, you're sitting right here with me. Other than that, you're not. Oh, yes. Verse 6, and raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show his exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by his plan, by grace, you've been what? Saved through faith, and not by yourselves. There had to be a plan involved to get rescued. It is a gift of God to what? Release me and you a plan. Oh, I've been saved by grace. I can do anything I want. Dummy. Not in the eyes of God. Not by works, lest anyone should boast. It's by relationship. It's by obedience. Remember, he gave us the formula. Do what? Deny yourself. Fight. Then you can follow me. For we are his workmanship if we're in that position. There's that position you must access, enter, and maintain. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should what? Walk in them. In other words, walk in that position. Walk in that position. Walk in that position. Walk in what? The risen state of being. It's resurrection. See, many people are awake, but they're not walking in that state of being. Psalm 17. Oh, hallelujah. See, now, sometimes you need to look in the mirror and say, get behind me. See those things walking in your eyes, you know. They start winking at you. Don't be afraid. Get rid of them. Man, when I was in the world, let me tell you, I look in the mirror and frighten myself. I could see things. I looked evil in my eyes. BC. Listen, you pick up spirits. You pick up stuff. You need to check yourself out. Look in the mirror and see if you see anything. If you begin to frighten yourself, get rid of it. You know what? There should be a place that you are maintaining self-deliverance every single day. There should be a self-deliverance every single day. There should be a constant disconnect of the world so that you're connected. Psalm 17, verse 13. Is everybody there? Arise, O Lord. Confront him. Cast him down. Deliver my life from the wicked with your sword. With your hand from men, O Lord, for men of the world who have their portion in this life, whose belly you fill with your hidden treasure. They are satisfied with children and leave the rest of their possession for their babes. As for me, you see, he was comparing himself to the world. See, this is how the world thinks. And this is how the resurrection state of being thinks. As for me, I will see your face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I, what? Awaken your likeness. See, you don't have to wait till you go home. You're to awake and then get into his likeness with resurrection state of being. Does everybody get that? And that state of being. Psalm 16, let's go back one. In verse 7. Let's speak it together. I will bless the Lord who has given me counsel. Did you get counsel today? Yeah. Not by me, by the Spirit. Amen. Why? Because the anointing you want to teach you, not man. I will bless the Lord who has given me counsel. My heart also instructs me in the night seasons. See, look, when you're not walking in that risen state, that resurrection state of being, you're not allowing conviction. You're not even looking for it. But when you're, why? Because when you're in that state of being, you're looking for conviction. Why? Because you want to stay clean. You want to stay pure. You're not looking to compromise or justify something that's unclean. You're not looking to promote yourself. You're looking to kill yourself. Glory. Is everybody okay? Well, nobody ran out yet, so we're cool. We don't even have to lock the doors today. Hallelujah. Glory. All right, let's go a little further. Where are we now? Verse 7. Okay. I will bless the Lord who has given me counsel. My heart also instructs me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me. Again, this is whether you know you're in relationship. This is whether you know you're what. If everything you do and every decision you make, the Lord's in front of you. Now, how many of y'all know the devil comes as an angel of light? Amen. Yes. Oh, God told me this. Remember, God never interrupts himself. He never promotes sin. He never promotes manipulation. He never promotes lying. He never promotes lust. He never promotes self. Never. If he's not first, then the devil is there. Oh, yes. I will bless the Lord who's given me counsel. My heart also instructs me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord when? When I feel like it?
Always.
Always. As soon as I'm up, grab hold. As soon as you're up in the morning, as soon as you wake up, put him before you. And then all day long. See, that's why when you wake up, you put him before you, then you go battle and move everything else away that's trying to take first place. That's why you should strike first. Because if you're not, you know how many people get up and just go, "Hey, good morning, Lord, I got to go to work now, see you later." They don't even battle. Amen. And they wonder why they have struggles. They wonder why they're easily deceived. They wonder why they curse out of their mouth. They wonder why their mouth is bringing curses on them. They wonder why their thoughts are goofy. Because they're not driving out anything. They're not driving out the enemy. You don't drive out the enemy. You're inviting him. Amen? All right. I have set the Lord always before me because he is what? At my right hand. Then what? I shall not be moved. I shall not be deceived. I shall not be misled. I shall not be manipulated. And I will not allow anything to become first place. But Jesus. Amen. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoices. My flesh will also rest in hope because it's submitted. Amen. And you're not going to let me hang out in hell, thank you. Amen. Nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You will show me the path of life, and in your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forever and evermore. In other words, he's going to build it. See, if the Lord is not before you, then the devil is. Amen? Amen? Romans 13. Oh, we got to get this in because things are happening. Amen. Romans 13. Training for reigning. Get behind me. I have to say that to myself sometimes. Get behind me. I'll think something else. Get behind me. Look at, nobody's made it yet. I don't care if you're a pastor or evangelist. I don't care if you, signs and wonders are following you and miracles and whatever. You don't judge someone by gifts. You judge them by fruits. Because even Jesus said, many will come before me. Yeah, they said, I healed, I did this, I rose to the dead. That's great. Jesus said, get out of here. I don't know you. Why? Because you practiced lawlessness. I was not first. The only thing you did is use my gifts to pocket your money. Hello? I see many people calling themselves prophets, living luxuriously, and using the gifts for gain. It's disgusting. Hi, I'm prophet such and such. Oh, no, you're not. Anybody comes to me and promotes themselves, I know it ain't God. And you're going to see more and more and more of this. More. Romans 13, verse 11. Let's speak it together. It says, and do this knowing what? The time that high, that now is a high time to awake out of what? Sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. In other words, get rid of anything that's trying to be first. Let us walk properly as what? In the day, not in revelry and drunkenness. See, people are drunk. People are drunk. Spiritually delusional things, deceptive. People are drunk. It says that the Babylon talks about the mystery Babylon, the harlot. What did she do? She got people to drink the deception, where people are becoming delusional, exchanging, becoming their focus is now on worldliness and fame and success. And self. Don't be in drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and in envy. Again, verse 13, let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and in envy, but what? Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. Don't let anything be first. Nothing. Matthew 13. Matthew 13. Verse 10. It says, and the disciples came and said to him, why do you speak to them in parables? And Jesus answered and said to them, because it has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it's not been given. Do you realize what's been given to me and you? Do you realize the message you got today from the Spirit of the living God? Do you realize we're accountable? You can't put this on the shelf. We are accountable. We are responsible. We'll be judged by what we do, what we say, our intents. These are mysteries that the Spirit reveals for revelation. Why? So we can walk out of the old and into the new and put Christ first and remove anything. Because when that flood comes, If we're an anchor to anything is first, it will wipe us out. For whoever has to him more will what? Be giving. And he who have who and he will have abundance, but whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. Therefore I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see. And hearing they do not understand. nor do they, or hearing they do not hear, nor do they what? Understand. In them, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled, which says, hearing you will hear and shall not understand, and seeing you will see and not perceive. In other words, you're awake, but you're not arisen. You're awake, but you're not arisen. For the hearts of these people have what? Grown dull. And that's what the enemy does. Grown dull. Their ears are hard of hearing. Their eyes, they have closed. They fall into compromise, complacency, and laziness, and self-will. Lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears. Lest they should what? Understand, grab hold, accept, receive, believe, and put it to work. With their hearts and what? Turn, stop it. So that I should what? Heal them. Listen, God wants to heal us. He wants to heal us. The most terrible thing is to have scars on the heart. That's what needs to be healed. Torment is a terrible place to be. Deception is a terrible place to be. Disconnected from the Lord is a terrible... See, you can pretend you have relationship. You can pretend that you're right with God, but you know whether you are or not. You know. You know. You can tell everybody you love Jesus, but you know he's not first. You know. He knows. But he wants us to know. Amen? So, what he wants to first do is get us to see, hear, and understand, come out of this place of deception, get us to the place of resurrection, and he wants to heal us. He wants to heal that hardened heart. He wants to heal that place in each and every one of us. And without removal of that evil presence in our life, we will constantly stay in that cycle. We will look fulfillment through everything else except for him. 1 Corinthians 15. Everything else must get behind us. 1 Corinthians 15. Verse 33. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33. Let's speak it. Do not be what? Deceived. Do not be what? Deceived. Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. Evil company. See, when anything else is first, you'll start to produce the fruits of it. You won't see it. Everybody else will. Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. Awake. Awake to what? Righteousness. And do not what? Sin. For some do not have the knowledge of God. I speak this to their what? To their shame. But someone will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Foolish one. What you sow is not made alive unless it what? Dies. Unless it what? Dies. Foolish one. And what you sow, you do not sow that body that shall be, but mere grain, perhaps wheat or some other grain. But God gives it a body as he pleases, and each seed its own body. All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of animals, another of fish, another of birds. There are also celestial bodies and terrestrial bodies, but the glory of the celestial is one and the glory of the terrestrial is another. There is one body of the sun, there is one glory of the sun, one glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars, for one star differs from another star in glory. So also is the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown in corruption, it is raised in corruption. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. And it is as written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. And the last man, Adam, became a what? Life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, and afterward the spiritual. The first man was of the earth, the man of dust, and the second man is the Lord from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly man. Now, you don't have to wait till you go home. It's now. It's a resurrection state of being. I'm going to close at Psalm 119. Psalm 119. Anything that tries to be first, get behind me. Amen?
Amen.
Let's speak it together. Verse 1. Is everybody there? What's it say? Blessed are the undefiled in the way. Now, let me ask you this. If anything is first, will you become defiled? Amen. Only when he's first are you undefiled. Blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord or the word of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek them with a whole heart. They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. You have commanded us to keep your precepts diligently. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. Then I would not be ashamed when I look into your commandments. I will praise you with uprightness of heart. When I learn your righteous judgments, I will keep your statutes. Oh, do not forsake me utterly. He was concerned. Why? Because he carried a fear and reverence and honor and respect. See, that's called the fear of the Lord. If you're not walking in the fear of God, then he's not first. It's impossible. Everything else is first. Everything must get behind us, no matter what it is. Oh, you have fallen that flood of dissipation. Amen. Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Have mercy upon us and let your grace abound, Master. I pray for each and every one here today. Counsel, correction, direction, conviction, and repentance. That each and every one here will turn away from everything and anything that has tried to place itself first in their lives so that you are first. You. Heal every hardened heart here today, Lord. Break every yoke of bondage and exchange our hearts for your hearts, our will for your will, our desires for your desires, our presence for your presence, and our life for your glory. In Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.